chickens just passed away and I feel really sad. Her name was Miss Abberline and she was an escape artist. A fox attack surviving, bossy applesaucy, dog terrorizing little ilk. You just got the sense she was deeply connected with her Tyrannosaurus Rex roots. She was wonderful. My favorite Miss Abberline story happened 2 years ago when she traveled half a mile down the road and left some poops on a neighbor's freshly paved driveway and new patio furniture. Incidentally, I do not endorse this behavior. Totally my bad. So I do not blame that man one little bit for chasing Miss Abberline home with a broom, because I knew he were never gonna catch that chicken. But then he infused the situation with a great element of surprise. You see, he was wearing a bathrobe with nothing underneath, and during the great chase, the belt came loose. Chicken chasing causes shrinkage, apparently. Well, Miss Abberline and I laughed for weeks over that one. It sure did make us chuckle. So, in honor of Miss Abberline, I would like to share 4 lessons caring for her and my other hens have taught me, for which I am deeply grateful. Lesson 1. Miss Abberline taught me that no food industry labels or buzzwords can ever hold a candle to good old-fashioned common sense. Recently, I got a publication in the mail from my local grocery store. It had these beautiful pictures and an article about how hard they try to source for local organic food. And it featured this picture of local free-range organic chickens from a local egg farm about an hour from my house. Local organic free-range, very sexy. I have raised a few chickens in my time, and I know that chickens need some square footage to ward off stress. And I also know that fresh air and sunlight are natural remedies that ward off illness. So for me, looking at that picture was both jarring and imperative. Because on one hand, we're looking at pictures of animals living in conditions that prioritize production over their psychological and physical well-being. But on the other hand, we're marrying those images with buzzwords that corporate America wants us to feel good about, like natural and free-range and organic. And when we have no point of reference for the natural needs and behaviors of the animal, the inevitable happens. Mass economies based on socially acceptable inhumanity. If the words below the picture say the conditions you're looking at are acceptable, then people who have no concept of a chicken or what it needs or its natural behaviors can rest easy. If it's legal, it must be ethical, right? Oh. Lesson 2. When we spend our money, we are always checking a box. In my grocery store, I have 2 egg options. I can buy local factory farm free-range eggs for $2.29 a dozen, or local pasture-raised chicken eggs from a permaculture farm for $4.25 a dozen. Yes, $4.25. Go ahead and have your stroke. Because the quality of life for the egg-laying hens in my neck of the woods literally hinges on local consumers' willingness or unwillingness to pay an extra $1.96 a dozen. This or this. When we demand eggs for $2.29 a dozen, we are checking a box. We are in fact checking the inhumane treatment of the animal box. There, one thing done off my to-do list. Because that's how it works in the real world. The only way corporations could ever keep up with our collective demand for cheap food is to industrialize the life cycle of the animal our food is made out of by degrading their living conditions, resulting in feedlots and factory farms that are totally legal and utterly inhumane. Fast and cheap and inhumane treatment of animals will always go hand in hand. The third thing Miss Abberline taught me is, once you crack, you can't go back. I confess, I have cracked. The first time I broke into an egg from a chicken that I raised as a baby, my perspective shifted. It's like it triggered the acetylcholine neurotransmitters in my brain and woke up my food conscience. Throw some seeds into a pot of soil and watch in awe as food springs forth, and you will get the same effect. I realized that there is great potential in the little scant shifts in our perspective. Do you know who understands this concept perfectly? Corporations. That's why they spend mass amounts of money trying to sway our opinion of them just a little bit. Because the tiniest little shift in our purchasing behavior can equate to billions of dollars of profit for an industry. Perspective equals profit. The same is true for our local farmers and the animals they raise when enough of us take tiny steps towards buying local from ethical growers in a seasonal manner. If enough of us decide that paying $4.25 for a dozen eggs from a local farmer to ensure the animal is treated humanely is worth the hit to our food budget, then the food industry would see that there is profit in raising birds like the ones that are raised on permaculture farms. This is called consumer-driven change, and it happens when enough of us are checking the same box. I know it seems simplistic and a little bit crazy, but it does work. Every journey has to start somewhere. Little tiny steps. Lesson number 4. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, Miss Abberline taught me that if you've got it in your head to chase a chicken, for goodness sakes, human, put on a pair of underpants. problems are totally freaking me out. Why do we have so many people without access to food? Most U.S. consumers belong to that 1% elite group of world occupants who has the greatest food freedom. Yet we elect to stuff our gaping pie holes with every fatty, saturated, sugary weirdness we can wrap our lips around. Who do we blame for that? How about us? Quick, name 5 indigenous foods that are in season in your region right now. 3? We don't even know how to feed ourselves. No, wait, I got this. This is about you and me making a critical food change right now. This may even be a moral issue.